This is a National Arts Center podcast. Find more great NAC podcasts on the Performing Arts at nacpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free.
Welcome to NAC Dance with Kathy Levy. In this podcast, Kathy chats with Aaron Watkin, Artistic Director of Semperoper Ballet Dresden, one day before the National Art Center debut of the company with his production of Swan Lake.
Aaron Watkin, welcome finally to Canada's National Arts Centre. It's so great to have you here.
Thank you very much. Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here.
We've been trying all year throughout 2017, throughout the 150th birthday of Canada, to shine a light on many of our Canadian artists who, for whatever reasons, left the country and have had incredibly successful dance and choreographic careers. And you're sort of the end of this great project we've been doing all season, and it's wonderful to have the Canadian premiere of your company and your work.
Yes, for me, I'm really excited to have the opportunity because it's the first time in 12 years that I've been able to bring my company and to come on the 150th anniversary, and it's just amazing.
Well, you run a huge organization. It's not necessarily an easy organization to move around.
Yeah, so it isn't.
It's been an interesting challenge. But let's go back. You were born in Cowichan, British Columbia, right?
Yeah, Cowichan Valley.
At Cowichan Valley. And so how does a boy from Cowichan Valley make his way to be the artistic director of the major ballet company in Dresden? It's a long and great story.
Yeah, I can do a condensed, easy version. But basically,
well, your bio makes me breathless, I have to say. It's a very wonderful story. So let's start
from
the beginning.
Yeah, so basically I was doing tap dancing at a local school in Duncan, which is the little town I'm from in the Cowichan Valley. And my sister, now I apparently got this wrong in my last interview and my mother corrected me.
Oh, very good.
My sister was also doing dance and she had seen the advertisement for the audition for the National Ballet School in the library. But the date for application was already finished. So my mom called the school and asked, can I come along? They said yes. I got to Victoria, did the audition, which was more just stretching and looking at me because I had no ballet training. And they invited me to go to the summer school.
Wow. How old were you at this time?
I was 12.
Okay.
So, I mean, the summer school was definitely my first time away from home and 5 hours on a plane, but it was a summer school, so somehow maybe it was a little easier for me to handle because I was coming back home. And then I got accepted into the school, and my mom said that right when I left, already in November, I called her to come home because I was very homesick.
I've heard this story from other dancers that we have interviewed, and being the mother of a hockey player who left home at 15, you know, Guillaume Côté said to me, oh my God, I can't believe that my mother let me leave at 11. We don't think about that, how traumatic an experience that can be.
Yeah, and I think I really thank my mom because I know it wasn't easy for her to, when her son is calling crying and I was really wanted to come home. She said, listen, just stay till Christmas. And when you come home at Christmas, if you really don't want to go back, you don't have to go back.
Great mom.
And somehow when I came home by Christmas, I was feeling better and I decided to go back. So it took about 2 years for me to really get over being homesick and then start to be very interested in ballet. I was continued to do tap dancing when I was there. Betty Oliphant arranged for me to do it outside, and then slowly that fell away and I got more involved. And then I ended up staying in the school to graduate in 1988.
I guess in that kind of environment too, you're not the only 12-year-old or 13 or 14-year-old who's in that situation. So there must be some kind of support in that or some kind of bond in that.
There is. I mean, we're in a residence, so obviously the residence becomes your home, and those dancers, those students that are with you become like your family, you know. And it's very, at a certain point, I really liked it. Then it turned to me having independence at quite a young age and getting involved in a profession that I thought was really exciting. It was difficult and daunting, but the whole thing got me involved.
And you were well recognized there. You got the Eric Brune Award after how many years for most promising student?
Yeah, I mean, every year they give that. I think after about 3 years I got that, or 4 years. Mm-hmm. And I had a very, you know, the director, Betty Oliphant at the time, really was interested in me, and she pushed me a lot. And we did flamenco and Spanish dance, but flamenco I had for about 4 years, which I loved. And I think that helped me deal with the ballet, because I was quite insecure and nervous about being not perfect, not good enough. But the flamenco, I really felt I could just express myself. So mm-hmm. It was a nice combination. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And do you remember what your first public role was?
In ballet?
Yeah.
It would probably be, I was Fritz in the Nutcracker here at the NAC.
Isn't that great?
Yeah.
I love that story. Yeah. That's great.
I think we made up, there was two casts. The first cast was very blonde, blue-eyed, and then the second cast was a bit more Mediterranean. And I was with Gail Skrella, a girl who also from the school, and we came here. I think I came here 2 or 3 years with the Nutcracker.
Right.
Yeah.
That's great. And so how old were you then?
That was like 1984, 83, 84.
Wow, 85. Fantastic. Do you have a memory of that sort of fire in your belly, like when you knew that this was a profession that you wanted to pursue?
With me, it was a little strange, because I knew I wanted to pursue it, but I was kind of not happy with what I was achieving. I wanted to be stronger, have a stronger technique. There was daunting elements to it as well, but I was in it. And it was definitely clear that I wasn't getting off this ride that I was going to go through. But I always, even from a young age in school, we rehearsed things on the side. We made little productions with Jason Beachy, the director of the dean of the University of Dance in Dresden, the Palooka School. So we would, on our free time, decide to put on a ballet production and get all the kids together, rehearse it all, and then show Betty. And she was really impressed that we did all this on our free. I always loved that side more, I think, than even my dancing for myself.
Mm-hmm. But you did become a member of the company at some point.
Yeah.
And what kind of roles do you remember dancing when you went from Fritz to what, for example?
Okay, so in the National Ballet of Canada, I came in for only a year and a half. I was under Lynn Wallace and Valerie Wilder.
Okay, right.
And the highlight would have definitely been, because I was first year corps de ballet. I mean, I did all the core stuff, and I did a few little demi-soloist parts here and there. But William Forsyth came to do the second detail. And I was not cast in it. He had first all principal dancers, and then through the process, for whatever reason, some of the principal dancers didn't dance, and he put really young new people in, and he created a role for me in that. So that was that was definitely the highlight of my 1.5 years being there.
Do you know, I think I remember seeing that. That was a huge thing for the National Ballet of Canada to have Bill Forsyth come and make a piece. Was there was a young a young dancer, I think her name was it Sarah Green?
Yes, yeah.
Oh my gosh, I remember just, I think it was one of the first Forsyth ballets that I saw.
Yeah.
I was blown away by his creativity and his ability to work with bodies. So the fact that he made a role for you must have been a huge honor.
I mean, I was, and like looking back, it's so funny because I just was so out of it as far as, my focus was the National Ballet of Canada. So of course I knew all the dancers and the rep, but I didn't know who William Forsyth was at that time. And so
a lot of people did, though, in Canada. He was pretty new to us.
People knew him. I mean, he definitely was already making a name. And so when he asked me, I was in that sense, what I meant to say is I wasn't feeling, he has an amazing way to make everyone feel so confident, and he's so encouraging and positive, that my process with him was not like the stress that it could have been if I really was aware of who this man was. So it was more casual, and he got a lot out of me, and it was just a wonderful experience.
But this also was the beginning of a very, very special relationship that exists even today. So tell us about that. You actually began to work with him, didn't you?
It's so funny that we're speaking, because he called me this morning here.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, he didn't realize I was in Ottawa, and we had a big talk.
We had a great time with him here. It was wonderful. We just, the company came in 2007, just at the very the very beginning of Company Forsyth. And
right.
We did a great shows with him. It was very special.
I've always had a very close relationship, which started in Canada. And then I left to Europe after a year and a half. I went to English National Ballet. Then I was in the Dutch National Ballet for 7 years. And in that time, Forsyth gave the Dutch National Artifact, the full-length Artifact. It was the first company to do it. And I was in both times we did it, worked with him again there. And he said to me, "Are you interested to come?" He kept asking me if I wanted to come to Frankfurt. He asked me that in Canada, and I said that as I had started classically, I really wanted to stay in a classical company first. I mean, I can't even believe I said that. And then maybe
really
later I would see. I mean, when you look back and you think, what an idiot. But in another way, I guess it was smart because I liked the experience I had in the classical companies. I got to work with him again in the Dutch National. And in 1997 in Sleeping Beauty, I was doing the pas de quatre, and I hurt my foot. I broke basically a bone in my foot. I was in a little cast, and I went to Frankfurt to visit my friends. And he saw me and said, "So, are you coming?" And I said, "Yeah, but my foot's broken." He said, "Yeah, and it'll get better. And so, do you want to come?"
Wow.
And so I just thought that was meant to be. I mean, that the fact that he kept asking me, and it's a man that I've always respected. And I also, there's something with his movement vocabulary that I feel so free and at home and so confident. I understand it, and I never did in classical ballet. I never had that feeling. So it was the first time I could really dance and be myself and show something special and be confident. So it was really an amazing, amazing. I stayed with him in the actual company only 2 years because he was transitioning at that point.
Away from Frankfurt Ballet to Company Forsyth.
And also away from more of his neoclassical works to much more improvisational and just going in a different direction. But it was a wonderful experience. And I remember thinking when I got there, I knew some of the dancers, but I remember thinking, wow, what a group. You know, when you first see them from where I'm coming from, they're all so diverse shapes and sizes and colors and personalities. It was like overwhelming. And then I realized what special quality every single person had that was unique. Because Bill doesn't take a dancer just because he needs a good this or a good that. He takes a person, like you would be Kathy. You're not just an extra girl doing a part, you know? So, and it was amazing to see he empowered us. He treated us like adults. He expected us to be proactive. He gave me a tape of Second Dito and said, "Here's the tape. When you know the steps, come in and then we'll do it."
Wow. You know? I mean, it's almost, as I'm hearing you talk about it, and, you know, I'm a huge fan of William Forsyth and love to bring his company, as I mentioned, and also love to bring other companies who are doing his work from the Ballet Frankfurt days as well as from Company Forsyth days. But it sounds like it's almost antithetical to the way some of the larger classical ballet companies are even still today structured.
Yes, yes.
I mean, yes, they care about the personalities, but it's much more about form and some kind of homogeneity. And Forsyth really was one of the first people to, I guess, break that down to build it up in a different way. Is that a fair assessment?
Yeah, that's a very fair assessment. I mean, obviously, every company has a different goal, and we're not doing in Frankfurt Ballet pieces that have corps de ballet that have to be the same, like the classics. But even saying that, if Bill was running a classical company, he would run it in a different way because he wants you to be an adult, so he treats you like an adult. Even if you're 16, he's very much on the level with you when he's talking to you. And a lot of dancers, when they meet him the first time, say they're just, you know, it's just magical. It's like they've never felt that type of energy before. Mm-hmm. So I learned a lot from him in that sense. And in our company, which is 57 dancers permanent, and I have about 6 to 10 dancers, apprentices, I really try to instill that. And when I started, I worked on the company culture internally. A lot of people work on the external profile of the company. But I mean, meaning what repertoire we have, which I was working on and getting their technique and everything. But the first thing I did was put a group of people together. I really selected a mix of what were classical, more modern, and a dynamic of people who were very much present. And I really, really engaged them to be themselves, to speak, to be part of a process. This all comes from Forsyth. And I feel we have what the most special thing that I'm proud of in our company, besides, of course, the level and whatever, is this element. Because when people come to audition or choreographers come, the first thing they say is, what an amazingly generous and open group of young, like, artists you have here. Mm-hmm. They're so supportive of each other. They're competitive, but in a good way. And they are really engaged with what you're telling them. We just smother them with information.
So you've created a very healthy environment, it sounds like.
I think so.
Did you have a sense that you were going to be named artistic director of this company? It was back in 2006, right?
Yeah, it was.
Because you'd still been dancing with, I mean, you know, when I remind myself of your trajectory, it's all my favorite people. I mean, you danced with Nacho Duarte, you danced with Ohad Naharin, you danced with, of course, with Bill. You know, all these people whose work, of course, I've been very proud to bring also to our audiences here in Ottawa. But, you know, to make a leap from being a dancer to being an artistic director, did you take that on? Was it something that you were surprised to be asked, or did you take it on saying, no, I'm going to take the bulls by the horn here and do this?
I would say, my mom always said to me that she thought I had a horseshoe up my ass.
I mean, love your mom. I hope I get to meet her during this dance while, like,
you will. But I don't think it was just the fact of luck. What I always knew inside myself, I always knew I was going to go to get into the school. I knew I was going to graduate. I knew I was going to go to the National Ballet of Canada, and I knew I was going to go to Europe. Then, funnily enough, when I stopped dancing quite young at around 30, I started getting opportunities from Bill to set his work.
On other companies. Yeah, for our listeners' edification, Bill has an incredible network still today of
amazing
people who go all over the world and set his work because it's in such a demand.
Exactly. So I had that opportunity. I had moved to Israel when I stopped dancing after Nacho, took 2 years off, started freelancing in Israel. So that's where I was teaching Batsheva or the kibbutz company in the north. Then I sent my CV around to about 10 different companies in Europe, and I paid for a trip to offer and teach 2 classes in each place. And then I got invited to most of them to come back, which became a regular thing. And on top of that, having the opportunity to set some of his ballets, it became pretty full time.
And in the networking was phenomenal.
Yeah. It's amazing. And it gets you in. I would say at that period, I was so current with the dance world because I knew what they were doing. I knew all of the dancers because I was teaching them. And it was such a great period of about 6 years to really get in tune with what I felt was lacking, what I felt was positive, how I felt I would like to do things. And in 2006, was it? Or I started in 6. I think 2005, I was invited to Dresden. Bill asked me to go set a Forsyth program.
Right. So I because by then, that. Bill Forsyth had a special relationship with Dresden, right?
Wasn't
at that time.
Yeah, what happened was he had asked me in 2004 to go to the Mariinsky, made up of a team of Catherine Bennett's and Noah Gelber, to set the first ever Forsyth program at the Mariinsky. I was just studying step text, Kathy was studying middle, and Noah was studying vertiginous. So what a wonderful opportunity to go and do that. And then I got a call saying, we need someone to go to Dresden to set a program.
Wow.
It was like sort of, I'd seen pictures of the opera house, but I really didn't know much about Dresden. And it wasn't, really in the limelight. It wasn't a company that was it had a company, but it wasn't touring a lot. And it was in the East and at that time pretty cut off. So they asked Bill, they were looking for a director, and they said, who would you recommend? And he said, well, if you work with Aaron, I think Aaron would be a good director. And if you are interested to work with him, I would be interested to have a relationship with the company.
Fantastic.
So obviously my first chance came more through the fact that Forsyth had pushed me into that. And then they needed a director for the school at the same time. And I said to Bill, he said, who who would you recommend? I said, Jason.
Another great Canadian.
Jason Beachy, who is my, we went through the school together, graduated in the same class, and we've been best friends since the day, you know, 12 years older.
I love that. These two young Canadian boys going off to run this huge organization. It's a fantastic story.
And we started the same day. So he took over the school. And what's interesting is in Dresden at that time, there wasn't a lot of, generosity between institutions. It was very private. So even the school, the Palooka School, famous school for improvisation, was in competition with the company. There were no...
wasn't a feeder organization.
It was not working and it wasn't looking for it. So the minute Jason started and the minute I started, all those walls came down and those institutions became like so close. And we started an apprentice program together and all this stuff. So it's, I would say what your question about when Dresden became more known with Forsyth was right from when I started, we brought middle on the first program. And since then, we have introduced, we have a huge Forsyth repertoire, mm-hmm. from classical to quintet now, to representing a big spectrum of Bill's repertoire. And he has come personally to rehearse us for everything. So he knows all of the dancers in the company.
So tell us a little bit about what Dresden is like. I mean, you've obviously, you and Jason together have, as you say, fundamentally changed the relationship between these organizations, built up an incredible company. Everybody says to me, oh, you're having Dresden Ballet. How lucky. I hear they're fantastic. I mean, now, you know, you're really a beacon on the international scene, which is a great credit to you. But what was it like for you to be there after all of this international opportunities you had? Yeah. You're sort of giving me that look like, oh my gosh.
Now, I would say that was a split thing too. I had been freelancing. I was based in Madrid and my freelance work was going very well, but it meant like I was away all the time. And after 5 years, I started really having a reaction to packing my bag and going away. I felt like I couldn't have a base of a social...
Where was home?
Friends. Yeah, yeah. Everything. It was hard. And then I got this opportunity to go to Dresden. Now, I had been living in Madrid, like 9 million people. Before that in Tel Aviv, before that in London, before that in Frankfurt, that was probably the closest. So I arrived in Dresden, and I remember when the first time I found out I was the director, and I was standing in front of the building with Jason, the opera house, and it's really a spectacular,
magnificent
opera house.
I mean, went there because of you. It's gorgeous.
You know, yeah. And I had been previously in London at the Royal Opera House, and I was in their little book. They have a bookshop, and it said the most beautiful opera houses in the world. And on one, we were on the cover, and on the other, it was the centerfold. So it's definitely, as an architectural building, it's gorgeous. Yeah, but it was in the East. And starting in 2006, if I think where it was and where it is now, it's just remarkable. It was a very interesting period. Our first program was called Rebirth and Renaissance, which timed exactly with what was going on in Dresden. Dresden was being reborn. The company was being reborn. And we were like going together on a journey. And what's been fascinating is that my audience has been so open because they weren't... Musically, they are specific. They know that Wagner and Strauss were the directors of their orchestra. We have one of the five most famous in the world orchestras, the Staatskapelle. So, but bat dance, they weren't really so particular. They want to know what they're seeing. And I felt like they'd missed about a huge chunk of time. They didn't know Yuri Kilian. They didn't know Forsyth. They didn't know Matt Sack. They didn't know anything really that had happened in 50 years. So I took them on a little journey. I introduced all of those choreographers with different pieces, and then we tried to go forward, and they've just been amazing. They've come with us on everything. Of course, classically, we're sold out, like, for years.
And most of the classical ballets, or many of the classical ballets, are your signature, are they not?
Yeah, I've redone. That's what I wouldn't consider myself really a choreographer. I'd say I really have always loved redoing, looking at the classics, so I'm pretty respectful to the traditional main pas de deux and things. I'm not doing a new contemporary version. The Swan Lake's very classical. But I choreographed all of the divertissement, everything else with more original tempos that are faster, productions that are shorter, and have a momentum that can take you through even if you're not a ballet person.
So when you're when you're choosing dancers, you're thinking of them as dancers who can do these big classical roles, as well as dancers who can do, as you mentioned, some of these contemporary ballet works, some of the famous choreographers that you've mentioned, Matt Zeck, Yuri Killian, etc., and also new commissions. So that's a really versatile type of dancer. Are they hard to find? Are they? Is it about how you train them? Is it about the environment that you create for them?
It is, yeah, it's all of that, I would say. It is not an easy thing to find because you need very, very skilled and diverse artists. But at the same time, it's a matter of experience. So we took, when I finished at the Kirov, I took four soloists from the Mariinsky with me who were totally classical and but exceptionally beautiful. And I took some from Nacho's company, from Killian, from really modern dancers. And what happened was so interesting because they all were so inspired with each other. They knew their craft, but it was almost like they were more inspired by watching how the other person did it. And over the years, I've given them like a menu that has every single thing that they're eating, everything all the time. So of course, maybe in the beginning, one excels a bit more in this, but now you have really, like my Benno, Yon Vallejo, who's doing the opening night of Benno, he is someone that you could see do Theme and Variations, Sleeping Beauty, the Prince, and then do Ohad Naharen, or now we're doing a creation of Hofe Schechter this year. He's first cast in that. All the contemporary choreographers want him. And when we were recently in the Joyce, most people just said what was extraordinary to see was how your dancers could move through the repertoire that you brought. Because they're used to seeing like a classical group or modern group, but we really, and that's one thing I'm very proud of because it is possible. People kept telling me it's not possible and you're going to have pea soup. It's like nothing. It just tastes like nothing. It's a little sip of this and a little sip of this and you're never going to excel. I say to them, well, come and see.
And you believed otherwise.
Yeah.
The company just had their, was it your New York debut?
It was our New York debut at the Joyce and with a full evening, but we've been twice to Fall for Dance Fall for at City Dance, Center right. as like a participant in a program.
Right. And so, and that went extremely well. I mean, I heard from many of my colleagues in New York, what a spectacular week that was. Yeah. And you've got a big smile on your face just remembering it. And I'm so proud because, you know, the fact that we were able to do this week in New York and then come up here for Swan Lake is quite a feat. So what was that? I mean, New York audiences are spoiled. They see everything. I mean, I like to, you know, think that our audiences are spoiled as well. But of course, they have 20 options every week.
Yeah.
So what was that like for you?
That was pretty, you know, I was obviously a bit nervous, but excited at the same time. And the opening night, we had subscription and mostly like sponsors. So he had said to me, it's a little bit of a, let's say, calmer audience. They don't really show so much. The first night, I heard their applause was nice. It wasn't over the top. And I was thinking, oh, I wonder how they liked this. But then everyone that came to speak to me, their sponsors, they loved it. And from the second night on, we did five shows. The audience's reaction was really amazing. They were so warm. And most people were very impressed. They'd said, we don't get an opportunity to see this type of repertoire, first of all. It's not people that are in their mainstream. They didn't know who Stane Solis was. They didn't know who, well, Joseph Hernandez, one of my soloists, did a creation, a world premiere that was beautiful. And I'm really, really pushing him. I think he's a new hope for us as a choreographer. And David Dawson, who is quite present. A lot of people in New York hadn't had the opportunity to see him. Mm-hmm. And then the second thing was about the dancers. So all in all, they see a lot. I think it's one of the most exciting audiences in New York at the Joyce because they're educated.
Absolutely.
And they just all, we had five reviews now and the last two were just basically, it wasn't enough and the company needs to come back and we need to see a full program with them. So I hope that this will lead to some other opportunities.
Fantastic. So you have this wonderful opportunity to really see and feel what's going on in Europe, bring some of Bill Forsyth's incredible full-length works. You're one of the only companies in Europe that has some of these works.
We are. In the world, within Impressing the Tsar, the biggest one, we're currently the only company. That's what we got offered, how we got to the Paris Opera this year and all those things. So a lot is through Bill, yeah.
Yeah, and Paris Opera, that must have been amazing.
That was like a world. I think the dancers were just in shock. Everyone was running around taking pictures all the time and thanking me every 5 minutes. I mean,
and impressing the Tsar is a spectacular, challenging, brilliant evening of dance.
It is. Yeah.
And we'll try and bring that one day, okay?
Yeah, I'd love to. We would love to.
But you have this, and then you're in America and you're a Canadian, and I know I like to remind you of your Canadian roots. How do you, is there a difference between what's going on in contemporary ballet in Europe versus North America? Can you sense that?
I would say, you know, for me, everywhere has its sort of focus. I would even say in Germany, there's a circle that all the Germany companies sort of work within or have until we came. Most people, choreographers and productions, were basically from a pool, the same pool. When I started introducing David or Alexander Ekman or Johann Inger or all these people, immediately the companies took them. But no one had gone out of their circle. So I would say also in New York, if we say, there's a very, of course, Martha Graham, Cunningham, all these icons that they've had. But as far as a diversity in the actual quality of movement, it's pretty aesthetic. It's pretty neoclassical, generally in New York. And if it's modern, it's also in a certain zone. It's ballet-ish. It's kind of, you can speak it. So I wasn't sure how they'd like the more really modern stuff. I'm talking specifically about New York right now.
What do you mean by you can speak it?
Well, arabesque, turn, pas de
bourrée. I see, you can give it a
stag
language.
Leap, whatever.
I see, okay.
Whereas if it's Ohad stuff, or I don't know, the choreographers we have been working with, Hofe Schechter, or Alexander Ekman, that's fully theatrical and speaking and different things involved. I don't know, this isn't appreciated to say, but I feel that in Europe there's a much, the extent of where you're going from A to B is much broader and they're much more open to seeing all of it. New York, they like, you see the ballet camp and you see the modern camp.
Yeah.
And they don't, if the people who liked our modern pieces didn't like the ballet pieces, some of them, people liked the ballet, didn't want to see the modern, but in the end, they had to see everything. And that's been my recipe in Dresden. Classical, neoclassical, modern on one program and getting people exposed to something they normally wouldn't have paid money to see. And then having an 80-year-old man say to me after middle, what an amazing, exciting piece. I never would have come to see this. So it's like, yeah.
Yeah, it's not unlike, I guess, you know, what you're saying is something that we try to do with our audiences as well. We want them to come and see Swan Lake, but we also want them to come and see Hofe Schechter.
You have an amazing, I would say, similar to, if I look at the Joyce Theater's programming in New York, the diversity is wonderful. And I also think that here at the NAC, all the companies you're bringing, I mean, I'm such a huge fan of Adolfa Binder and the Pina Bausch Company in general for now. And all the companies that you've brought through here, obviously your public gets exposed to everything. That's wonderful.
Thank you very much. And I appreciate that. And tell us a little bit about what they're going to see with your Swan Lake, because this is very signature to bring this company to come to Canada, but with your work.
Yeah. I mean, as I said, I'm a fan of everything. So if I'm going to show a classical production, I'm not looking to make it modern, and there's nothing wrong with that. I just will do it in the vein it's in. So my Swan Lake, I was very influenced by Eric Brune, by his productions, not so much by him because he wasn't around as much when I was there. But he did a Swan Lake in 2 acts and 4 scenes with 1 intermission. I followed that. I like that structure. And I incorporated at the end of the White Swan Pas de Deux, the happier ending, which Eric had as well. Mm-hmm. And the Neapolitan dance was influenced by Ashton. I would say my Swan Lake is a classical version that is a little, I hope, just a fresh new look, and that the momentum can take you through this piece. I'm not big on long miming and gesturing and, you know, hours of explanation. I think you should be able to come in and sit down and follow the basics of the story. Swan Lake's always been something that there's, if you go into the reading and you're going deeper than she turned into a swan, the grandmother cried the tears of the lake, invited it up. All these tales that they have, you can go into layers. But the basic thing of it is a momentum. a rhythm and respecting Tchaikovsky's music. Because when he wrote these this score, it was not accepted. It was not, the premiere went horribly. And people thought his music was way too big and symphonic.
Yeah, it's important
and
for us to remember that. Yes.
All this stuff was just like out of the question. And then after it came back years later, and it was quite a success. So I asked my conductor to give me the original tempos. And so before I started the choreography, I worked the choreography on that. So I think one interesting thing is that our orchestra, who's quite, you know, well known, that ballet is definitely not their most exciting thing to play. When they got the Swan Lake, they said to me, "This is the first time we can play this music how it should be played." And they were speaking mostly because of the tempos. And so I hope that you can just sit down and flow through a story and escape from your reality into this world. I mean, it's a little crazy in world of a swan, a woman who's a swan. How realistic is all this stuff? But it's a love story, you know. And
yeah,
at the end in my version, it is sad and happy because they do go into the lake and are drowned in the lake, so they die, but the lake is representative of the grandmother's tears, so it's something warm and like a home and a place where they can be united, their souls in the afterlife. So it's a positive negative.
I know I have to let you get back to rehearsing for the premiere, which is tomorrow night. I'm just curious, you're going to be with Dresden Semperoper Ballet at least till 2020.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What's next for the company?
I'm trying now. I mean, these are the things that I had my eyes on: Pina Bausch, on Hofe Schechter, on big choreographers for a long time. So I will be continuing. I will be focusing a bit more now on creating exclusive repertoire for us, as far as also creations. I've brought in a lot of pieces for us to do that I wanted the company to do, iconic works. But the next part now is I want to get a lot more creations for our company. Saying that, I have never had Pina Bausch, and I'm so excited that in 2020 we will be premiering a wonderful work called Ephigenia auf Taurus.
Beautiful.
It's a Baroque piece with five singers, and it's one of the most beautiful pieces I've seen, and we will be the only company in the world outside of her company to do it. So that's going to be something pretty special. And just continuing, we have so many tour opportunities. It's kind of like the first 10 years were work to get us somewhere. And we're right in the moment now with you inviting us here, going to the Joyce. We're going to Sadler's Wells in June. We've just been to the Paris Opera. We have an Asian tour next year. It's like everything that we've worked on now is our moment to start to enjoy it. So rather than thinking what the next year's my plan will be, my plan is that this new generation, the pioneers have retired, the new generation is going to go out and present us, because so many people have heard of our company, but not a lot of people have seen our company. So it's going to be about going out and really enjoying now all of this and keeping ourselves going, creative, and getting out and seeing people.
Well, of course, we love to celebrate our Canadian artists who are doing such incredible things outside of the country and in the country. Mm. I'm sure one day you'll be commissioning some Canadian choreographers to make work, and having you back here, I hope it's as special for you as it is for us.
Well, it is. It's wonderful. And everyone's so excited to be here.
And your whole family's here.
My family's pretty huge, but like a lot of my family came from Vancouver to come and see this, and it's some of their first time to see any dance.
Well, it's very apropos then that it's Canada's National Arts Centre that's welcoming you here for the first time, and I'm sure it will not be the last.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your time. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
That's all for this NAC Dance podcast. Send us your comments and questions by email at nacpodcasts@gmail.com. And don't forget, you can subscribe to NAC Podcasts at nacpodcasts.ca. You can also find us as a free subscription in the podcast section of the iTunes Music Store. Until next time, goodbye from Canada's National Arts Centre.
This has been a National Arts Centre podcast produced in Ottawa by NAC New Media. Send us your comments and questions. Email us at nacpodcasts@gmail.com. Visit the podcast section of the iTunes store, where you can rate and comment on this podcast. We love to hear from you. Remember, you can find more great NAC podcasts at nacpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Centre on iTunes and subscribe for free. Until next time, goodbye from Canada's National Arts Centre.